Our guest is still in the studio in the person of Dr. Henry Herbert Lahte. Of course, I almost said mom, but he's a mom as well. Well, he is the presidential candidate for the GCPP. And Doc, let me just come back to you, remind you of that question. So the biggest challenges facing our country.
Yes, the challenge is because we import too much. It started a long while ago. After the Champagne regime, we've been importing more than before. During the Nkrumah regime, he actually made sure that we had factories, we were producing our own food in quantities, and everything was going quite well. But after the Champagne regime, it looks as though we've been importing more than we export. Although we're exporting traditional products like cocoa and others, we're exporting enough cocoa, enough timber to give us enough revenue. But right now we don't have that much timber, and our cocoa export has gone down as well, and the prices keep fluctuating, and we haven't prepared ourselves by actually improving our export base of our country. So we end up importing too much, and when you import too much, your city depreciates. And when it depreciates and you don't have enough revenue, everything goes up. We have to tax more people to be able to get the revenue to push the country going. That's why we are suffering.
And how do you intend to fix this? I mean, it's easy to talk. Talk is cheap.
Absolutely.
And everybody has overdiagnosed the problems. What makes you different?
You see, I'm going to say export. I've been an exporter for years. I'm one of the top exporters in Ghana. I export organic papaya. We're the largest organic exporters in the world. And when the late Dan Lahte was talking about domestication...
That's your father.
Yes. He knows and he knew how, because he was advisor to General Champagne. When he was talking about domestication, we were producing, we were exporting. He said, eat what you grow what you eat, stockpile, and then export. If you don't earn revenue, if you don't earn any revenue, how are you going to do it? And to earn revenue is not only through agriculture. You can also do it through energy. I've been talking since 2012 that we should go to start going into energy export with solar in a big way. We haven't done that. If we could go into solar, there's a lot we can do. As I talk to you, all the first world countries, Germany, England, UK, UK is England, USA, they're all going into solar in a big way, and it's creating jobs there. We have a comparative advantage compared to those countries. They have only 6 months of the year of sun, and we have 24/7. So we can put more resource into energy and create an environment for the business of General Motors, Mercedes and others to come and put in their inputs here. They'll come and produce electrical cars here for us. We'll build an electrical car business. We'll be able to have enough solar energy to even export to Europe and have trillions of dollars in our pockets. Once we get that resource, what can't we do? We can improve our education, we can improve infrastructure, even better than we're doing now. And it's through infrastructure, education, that is where the country can get for.
I'm curious though. Yes, it's good that we produce our own, but the world has become a global village. And if indeed we're just looking to just patronize what we grow or what we produce alone, how are we able to be competitive on the global market?
You see, when it comes to solar, nobody has a comparative advantage at the moment. We have a good advantage in sub-Saharan Africa with the sun.
Indeed.
And these big companies are looking for a place. If we sit down and we don't do it, by the time we realize they've actually produced enough solar in their own environment that it will not be any effective, just like they've done with the oil. So once we give them the chance to make some money, or Ghana make some money for another 20 years, we would have sorted ourselves out. If we do not produce anything, because we say there's a global, I'm producing, I'm fighting with other, African small, other small producers in the world, you have to compete. If you're going to say because of the global world, you're not going to do it, everybody can do it, do it and do it better, because we have so many Ghanaians who are so good outside, and they are coming in, and you can see the youth who are coming in now. They're all very resourced. So if we can give them that chance to develop even better through solar energy, we'll do much better, much, much better than.
So your message is what? Domestication?
And agriculture.
Agriculture.
And then
domesticate the food, and then domesticate the sun as well.
Absolutely.
I've heard you say that. How do you domesticate the sun?
Look, if you allow big business to come in, which they were looking for maybe 4 years ago when I was talking to you, there was a German company, I've forgotten the name, they wanted to come in and put money into the solar. And when you put money into solar, what it does is you will be able to generate electricity from here, build electrical cars, by building solar panels. Once you build the solar panels and you produce the solar panels here, and then you're exporting, that's domestication. You've done it. Your own people have been able to have those skills to be able to generate the energy from here and then to export it. Once we do it ourselves, that's what is local production. That's what is called domestication. Others are doing it. And if we're going to just sit down and let them continue, as I talk to you, Morocco has borrowed from the African Development Bank and they started exporting solar to Spain. Are we going to sit down like we've always sat down and allow others to improve, and then we go and buy? Look, all of us here, we're driving Toyotas, Mercedes, all of these cars we're driving. If we create the environment that Mercedes or Toyotas can make more money in solar, in electrical cars, they'll come and put their...
Is it a matter of just building panels? Because I've spoken to solar energy experts and energy experts, and they say, look, you can't run industries on solar power. Maybe for heating of domestic residences...
Things have changed.
And powering phones and things like that, yes. But how do you run a Valco on solar power?
You can build solar parks. Mm-hmm. Things have changed, and now it's cheaper to use solar. Sometimes it's so expensive. But even now, when you look at the hydro is even expensive because of the climate change. We're not getting the energy that we want. And then we've gone into thermal, which is very, very expensive. Solar is there for us. If you sleep and wake up, the sun is there.
Who's using it to maximum benefit? Who are your role models as far as solar energy application is concerned?
As I talk to you now, Morocco is doing it in Africa. Those are the people who have started it. So if we sit down and we don't think out of the box, and we say, who is doing it? Even if other people are not doing it, we should be the first
Morocco
to do
it. Is building solar panels. That's it. Is that what we're going to copy?
You are not copying. The thing is that you are just talking about Global Village. Now you can get on the internet and find out a lot of things that is happening. As I talk to you, even in Germany, they've been able to create what you call solar tubes. And they will be able to put energy in it and sell it. And we are sitting here, they don't even have the sun. And they are doing more. And we are sitting here, we have the sun to ourselves, and we're asking questions.
So by local production,
we should try and do something about it.
By local production, we're looking at us producing the panels, whatever that will store the energy, and everything else that comes with it. And then what?
What will happen is, the investors who come, those who have the knowledge, like they have in Europe and others, and they don't have enough resource, the sun there, will come and put the investment here, since we have a comparative advantage, and train our boys, and train our people, and then they'll get the skills, and we'll improve and move on.
Let me just ask you this question. What are the good points about the current energy policy that we have?
You see, over a period of time, we did well by giving electricity to almost everybody. And the process, now industry, is challenged. Big time. Over the period too, because the climate change is not helping, and our hydro is not giving us enough electricity as we want, we've now gone into thermal production. And the thermal is very, very expensive, and that is a big challenge. If we don't have a resource to be able to, buy the crude oil to feed the thermal, what are we going to do? Good, we've gone into gas production, which is also excellent to help us around. But we need to have more sources of energy, not just hydro and thermal. You have wind power as well. We could go there. Biomass is also there. But we have to top it up and continue. If you don't have energy, you can't move. You don't have energy, you will not industrialize. You don't have energy, you can't do anything. It's important for us to be able to have, like they say, where there's light, there is life. Without light, without energy, we cannot move our system forward. Let's get more sources of revenues. And solar energy is part of the areas that we can get sources of energy to move the country forward.
It's been 24 years since the Fourth Republic.
Yes.
The problems of this country still persist. And you think that you're the one person who can...
We.
Okay, so when you talk about we,
yes,
what do you mean?
I mean all of us. We should start thinking out of the box.
So you're talking an all-inclusive government, for instance, should you be handed the power?
Absolutely. We should do it. Look, before I got into politics, I have friends like you who sit at home and discuss about Ghana, and we never come onto television to express ourselves. But we have people, I know people, friends of mine and friends of friends, who are brilliant at what they do. And they're living here, but they're working for companies outside. Mm-hmm. Some are engineers, some are scientists, and things like that. And they have all the skills that I'm talking about that we can use to move Ghana forward. If we don't do it, who is going to do it for us? Who is going to do it for us? And we haven't done it for nearly 24 years or something mm-hmm. like that. And look at what is happening. Things are getting worse by the day.
And you think this GCPP holds the key to developing this country?
We hold the keys, and I know how to get the people on board.
Before you tell me how, let's look at numbers. So in the 1996 results, GCPP took part in the parliamentary. You had some 1,485 votes. In 2000, you took part in the presidential elections. 67,504 people voted for you, representing 1.04%. In 2004, there was no presidential candidate for GCPP, so you went back to your parliamentary business. You had 0.05% of the parliamentary vote. That's 4,690 Ghanaians voted for you. And then in the 2012 presidential elections, which you took part in, you garnered 38,223 votes, representing 0.35% of the presidential total. You actually beat the CPP.
Yes.
Is that your claim to fame?
No. That is in the past. We're looking to the forward. They always say, you're just as good as the last sale. We have to do better than with
you
the last
one. You haven't even reached 0.5%.
Yeah, that doesn't mean you can't do it.
It means a lot.
It doesn't mean you can't do it.
Very few Ghanaians are listening to your message.
Positive mental attitude. If you believe in anything and seriously believe in it and you work at it, you'll be able to achieve
it. Well, if I believe that I'm going to come into $10 million tomorrow and work hard at it, it's not going to happen.
That's not what I'm talking
so
about.
So maybe it's about reality and not.
You work at it and you achieve it. It's somebody looking for sale. And if you sit at home and they expect the sale to come to you, it will never come to you. You keep knocking on doors. The more no's you get, the closer you get to the yes.
But you're going from 0.35%. You need to triple your effort just to get to 1% and then multiply by 50.
No.
So 150%.
Don't go there.
150 times what you're doing now to get to 50 plus one.
You watch us, because look, since the late Danlati died, the party has become very, very strong. We are in all the 275 constituencies.
Did he will the party to you?
No.
How did you become the leader?
I'll tell you what happened. When my father died, there was nobody around to really fight the fight for them. When he died, I called everybody around. I said, look, the old man is dead. I'm sorry. So they warmed up to me, said, look, we hear that at one point, or over the period, you've been financing the party, which is true. So when he went, the party decided that, because I'd spoken to most of them, they warmed up to me and said, look, we want you to come and join.
But is it true that you asked to be chairman and leader of the party?
Yes.
Why?
Why?
Because you were the money bags?
Maybe not. But what had happened was, because I warmed up to them on the phone, when my father died, and not only that, I knew all of them. I was working with most of them anyway. So we started talking to try and not let the party die. In the process, we decided that, okay, you have a good shot at it. And I said, fine, I will. Why not? Because I believe in domestication. I believe that we need to do something. Over the years, I've been successful at age 27. I'd become a member of the million-dollar table in Europe. MDRT means one of the top underwriters in the world. By 29, I had become a manager of a large insurance company, Royal Insurance. Then I came home over a period of time and set up an export business with charcoal, coffee, chilies, and then we became the largest exporters of organic papaya. At least I have a track record. I've traveled around the world, going to exhibitions and things like that.
Track record as a businessman?
As a businessman, yes.
Not as a politician?
Not as a politician, but you can always try. Never give up. Always try something that maybe your hands... you have never tried before. But over the period, don't forget, I come from a political home. My grandfather was a deputy governor, Henry Herbert Mam. I was born in his house, you know. So. And then my father has been in politics. As a child, he always talked politics. Even when I grew up, Dad would always talk to me with politics and not with family matters, 5 minutes of family matters, and then he'll try me out to see if I understood what was going on. So over the period, meeting different politicians throughout the world coming to see my father, and also I was very interested in politics when I was a child. I used to watch most of the programs, Robin Day, interviewing politicians and watching how they answered questions. And as I grew up and I started doing things, I realized that just being a good businessman, having money in your pocket, is not the best thing. You can live well, have the best cities, travel around the world, and if people are suffering, and you, because you enjoy yourself, you don't care about what's going on, then what is your use?
It's interesting, you talk about where you grew up, your grandfather, your dad, we all know very well. How much of your father's CPP indoctrination did you pick up?
A lot of it, to be quite honest, because as a child, I remember when Kwame Nkrumah was overthrown, and overheard him talking to somebody that he would never be in politics alone now, because when businessmen sit down and do nothing about it, things that should not happen, happen. And I've listened to him with, I can't mention all the names, but the top Kojo Botiu has always come to the house. In London, I met him with the former foreign minister, Ayekumi. We met former agriculture minister for Liman, ASA Aban. I met so many, and they discussed different topics. And over the period, you don't realize, it gets an into you. I didn't realize I was into politics until this. My party members asked me to take over and help the party move on so that it doesn't die. Then I realized, oh, so he's always had it there. But although we discussed things, it never occurred to me that I would actually go into politics.
But you've done a lot in the agricultural export sector. Yeah. You're big, one of the largest exporters in Ghana.
Yeah.
Why don't you stay there and create employment opportunities for young people, mentor young business people? Why do you have to go into politics?
I did. And I do. Because most of the... When we started, I was only in my 30s working in the export sector. And over the period, I helped so many people in the charcoal business, right? But because of the environment and everything, I quit the charcoal and then went into coffee. We help the farmers by, as we export, they're able to earn more money. And then in the organic, we help most of the farmers. They were able to buy their own pickup trucks. They were able to build their own houses. How long can you continue just helping a few Ghanaians if you have this chance to be able to do a bigger thing? So it just fell into my lap in a way, although it wasn't easy. I have been able to go around every village, every town to build our party. And building the town and talking to the people, you're helping young people to also have ideas. Maybe not, I may not be present in my lifetime, but the ideas that I put into their minds, the positive mental attitude, they could pick it up. And then when I'm gone, like my father is gone, they will also pull those energies and mental attitude, positive mental attitude I put in them, to move the party forward, and then we could get what we want. As we're talking now, you can say even the government is trying to do some sort of diversification when it comes to energy side. Local content, they put in a local content law, which is going on, and this is by many Ghana goods. When I hear that, I'm happy, because if we do not produce, not only in agriculture, anything that we do, we do not help our business people to produce, we'll not get anywhere. America is doing it. China has done it, haven't they? And the Asian Tigers, they are all doing it. If you say the whole global world, everybody's doing it, it's not you, so you won't do it, it's entirely up to you. Then you're going to go broke and have no money in your pocket. We have to do something.
So you're using the platform, the presidential candidate platform, as a stage to get your ideas out to Ghana, is that it?
Ideas, and if anybody can pick it up, and if the Ghanaians think that what I'm saying is what they want, they should vote for us.
So you don't care if you don't win?
I care if I don't win, but if they think we can do the job, give us a chance and let's move Ghana forward.
What
please.
If they say that we don't want you?
Then I don't win. That is why we're in the race to win. If we're able to win, and the youths are with me, and they know we are able to do. Look, most of them have traveled outside. Most of the week that I see a lot now. Most of them have traveled outside. That doesn't mean that those who haven't traveled don't know. I went to a university just recently, Kenny and USC, and they were enthusiastic. That energy has got to be put into something, for Christ's sake. If we don't do it, who's going to do it for us?
Indeed. So if they don't give you the nod, you don't win, like you say. But you've been in the group and yet you've still impacted lives. Why wouldn't you want to just stay there within the group?
Why just stay there? If you can do better. Mm. Why just stay there? Why don't you put your views and your ideas to the public to help shape Ghana? If I don't win, I can still help shape Ghana by talking like we're talking now and letting us realize that we are capable of moving Ghana forward.
But of course, if you win, it makes things better.
Of course.
You've been on record to have said that democracy will be the loser if the EC shuts down the smaller parties.
Yes.
How do you mean?
What I mean is, you see, when there's a turbulence, most of the political parties, most of the big parties, listen to the smaller ones and we calm the nerves down. We calm everybody's nerves down. And in a multi-party system, we should give people the chance, even if they cannot win, to jaw, not war. So if you're closing smaller parties down, then you're closing down the democracy. If you're shutting them down, you're closing down democracy.
They're only going to do that if you're not able to meet the requirements.
And the requirements that most people are talking about, people don't really understand it. Look.
How do you understand? Yeah.
Look, when it comes to conditional registrations, they are saying you must have a branch in all the regions.
Like two-thirds of
the district. You must have it. And in addition, you must be organized not less than two-thirds of the districts in all the regions. Mm-hmm. Branches mean division. The members of your party, you should be able to have all your constituencies and now regional executives. That's what it means. It doesn't mean offices. Where it says office is in section 13, 14, and 15. 13 and 14 requires you to show them your assets and expenditure, and assets and liabilities, and also your sources of fund, cash, any kind. And once you've done your sources and your statement of account, it will all be there. Your general secretary and your national will sign. And then, if you don't have a national office and regional offices, then the EC may cancel your license. That is what it is.
What is this?
But some people have gone wrong, done it wrong, and using the condition of registration to mean the branch is an office. No, it's not an office.
What is the GCPP status currently? Do you meet all the requirements of the electoral commission?
We have all of the regional offices, and we have our national
office.
All the 10 regional offices, we have it. And all our national office. And we have more offices on top of that.
How many?
We have nearly 80 to 90 offices around the country.
But that doesn't that quite...
That is not the rule. The rule does
what
not...
What is the rule?
The rule does not say... The rule says, when they mention office, it's section 15. Mm-hmm. If you don't have the regional and national office, then they'll take you out.
So what is this
the branches,
talking about?
The branches they are talking about, offshoots of your party. Mm-hmm. That's why you should have to be in all the country.
Meet? How do they meet, those offshoots?
Let's just talk about certain we can meet anywhere and discuss. The offshoots,
like under trees?
Yes. Not under trees, so for Christ's sake.
In churches, mosques?
We can meet anywhere and have
Is
a meeting.
Is that rather haphazard?
But listen.
And not scientific.
Don't get it wrong, because that is where everybody has gone wrong. Thinking that when they say branches, you're talking of offices. No! You're talking of people. You should have your people in your constituencies. You have your people in the regions. So, and they should not be in less than two-thirds of the districts and in all the regions. That is what it is. So when I'm saying if you need section 13, 14, and 15 to qualify, and that is the rule, finish.
Right. So how do you identify these members of the GCPP in these branches? Do they all have cards, for example?
They all have... Look, the world has improved now.
So how do you identify your members?
The members, we have their telephone numbers. We call them all the time. They call me every minute.
That's a massive database.
If we are even on WhatsApp...
How many members do you have?
We have...
Across the country?
Look, let me tell you. Some people think when you have 1 million or 2 million, what shows that they are your members? You listen to me.
I wouldn't pay dues to a party I don't belong to.
Listen to me. What happens is, what I've realized is that a lot of these people belong to all the parties. When you try to search up, some people of them are NDC, some of them are MPP, some of them are, NPP. Mm-hmm. And they have some filthy people who join all the parties. I can tell you easily, that at the National Congress, we had over 3,000 members who are GCPP. But at the same time, if I tell you that we have 400,000 members, which we have, our 600, who out of that 600, we don't know those who are, belong to other parties. You understand? So I will not stand on that and say, this is our.
This is. So how do you plan?
You plan because you know what you have, and you go according to what you have.
Do they pay dues to you?
Sorry?
Do they pay dues
to
the party?
Yes, we get the pay dues, and then we have business. I'm a businessman.
How do they pay dues?
We only have phone numbers. No. That's not what I said, that we only have phone numbers. We have their telephone numbers. We have their home address. We have everything.
So you go to their houses to collect dues?
I don't. My party members, I cannot go everywhere. Mm. My party executives
when
do that.
When I say you, I mean your party.
My party executives do that. We have party executives throughout the whole 275 constituencies.
From door to door, collecting deals.
Absolutely. As I talked to you, I was just in Kumasi just recently. And we were on the doorsteps of people.
Let's stay in the Ashanti region, because you're also on record to have said that you will gain 2.5 million votes from Ashanti region.
And then the rest, the other parties can share.
Was this a dream?
It's not a dream. You have to have a target.
How do you get 2.5 million votes?
You have to have a target to go at something. It's not a dream. Like I'm telling you, if you want to dream, even dream bigger than the ocean. And then go for it. You will achieve somewhere. If you don't have a dream, you don't have a target, what's the point of being...
What's your message for the people of Ashanti?
The people of Ashanti is that, you know, domestication. Eat what you grow, grow what you eat. It's what can turn this country around. You have a lot of farmers. We will help the farmers to produce more, look for market for the farmers, and what they will produce, we'll put into manufacturing, add value, and then export. It's as simple as that. So when you produce, you know you have a market. And the GCP will create an environment where there will be more businesses where you are to be able to buy your produce for export.
But you are transplanting your business model onto Ghana. How will that work? I'm sure this is the model you use for
exporting. Why would it not work? What's the way to make it work?
I don't know. You tell me. It looks so simple.
It sounds simple, but it's hard work. It's never that simple. As I talk, it's hard work to be able to even have a farm to produce things. It's not easy. You have to give them the resource, give them the stimulus to work. And as you give them stimulus, give them capacity building. You understand what I'm saying?
Let's look at funding issues with all of these things that you talk about. Like Kafi said, it looks so easy. Yes, talk is cheap and all
because
that.
The way I talk.
How are we looking at funding all of these ideas that you share?
The way I say it's easy, but working it is not that easy. It's tough. Look, I drove around the whole country and it wasn't easy. We even had an accident at one point on our way to Suyani. But I kept it to myself. We hired a car and did the whole Bronx Ahafo region. It's not easy. It's easier when you achieve something because people don't see when you go through the hard work.
Okay, so my question was how we're going to fund all the good ideas, the beautiful ideas that you share with us.
Look, how are we going to fund it? We can get our own resource by going to not only to the World Bank or IMF or through commercial banks. You create a situation where our banks will be more visible, where our banks will be more willing to risk and pay and put money into agriculture, where our business people will come home because they can see we have other Ghanaian business people outside who have got resources, who are, how can I put it, bankers who can bring ideas to Ghana for us to move forward. If you don't create an enabling environment, nothing will happen. Nothing. The questions you're asking me is as though we can't do anything, so we should sit down and do nothing.
Well, you're telling us what you're going to be doing, and we want to know exactly how that
you
intend to do
it. But sometimes you can't always tell the real how is done. It's when you're in the middle of it and you're doing it and it's happening. For example, when I was about to step out of my business, people said, how are you going to go into export business and be the world's number one exporter of organic papaya? What am I going to tell them? Tell me. But I did it. And in the results, we happen to be the largest producers and exporters of organic papaya in the whole world. Did you believe that we could do that in Ghana? We did it with all the constraints. So with that, I can tell you that we can do a lot more once we get all Ghanaians on board and the youth, youth want jobs. If we can help create an environment where you have a Ghana economic empowerment for our youth and for business and for those who want to move Ghana forward, I'm sure we can do a lot more.
This can all happen if we don't waste our resources with corruption. And I was listening to a conversation on CNN, and the IMF boss was calculating the cost of corruption to the world economy being at, I don't know, it's fantastic, but 3% of the entire world's economy is lost through corruption. Yes. I wonder what the figures are in Ghana. So there's this big conversation about corruption in Ghana, and then you, on the other hand, have been reported to say, look, we should stop branding the country corrupt because it will take away something from us. What exactly did you mean?
What I mean is, if there is corruption anywhere, nobody wants to go there. If there is corruption anywhere, no businessman would like to go there. And sometimes we overblow what is going on. As at now, you see, it got to a point where you can't say things because when you say this, oh, you're NDC or NPP. But that has to stop. It has to stop, for Christ's sake. Because even though there's corruption in Ghana, it's everywhere else. And for the first time, you can see this government trying to do something about it. But the law, that's what the English say, it's a long arm of the law. It takes a long time before they're able to prosecute people. And just because somebody has found to be corrupt and he's going through the process, they expect a military rule system. The government must go and arrest them, put them in jail. When are they going through the law courts? They don't give out. Sometimes we want to do well. All of us want to do well. And we're impatient to take time and get things done properly. They want people just straight away to be put in jail. Let the long arm of the law take its course. As I talk to you, even Europe, the corruption there is 990 billion euros. Read my lips. 990 billion euros. And you know what? In the UK and these first OECD countries, these are the rich countries, they used to have slush funds. They bring into the developing world to win contracts and then tempt our people. I'm not saying our people should do it. They should realize that when they come, they should refuse it and not let it happen. But they had billions of dollars to come and grab contracts. Billions. And now that is embarrassing for them. They are now trying to find a way. And that's why they called that summit, to embarrass African leaders. And then what did Buhari told them? He said, where is our money? Yes, I realize that my people are corrupt. So can we have our... But because that costs billions, you think the UK will pay them out? If they take it out, their whole economy will be in a mess.
So you think that the current government is on track in fighting corruption?
It's on track in corruption, but that does not mean there's no corruption. Are you telling that the NPP, when they came, there was no corruption? Are you telling me that?
Well, we're not looking at
corruption. Is everywhere. What we have to do is to solve it as we go along, not tag one political party to it.
What's the way to solve?
The way to solve it is for us to be aware of what is going on. Because look, there are two things. Where somebody is taking the money for profit. We have a culture. It's a difficult thing as well. We have a culture where when you go to a chief, you go and give schnapps and things. When an adult does something for you, you go and thank them. We should differentiate between those things and don't blame our people that they are also corrupt. Because we have a culture that looks like corruption. It's not corruption. It's because of the way we are. But where we should define corruption is where somebody is taking a position and using that position to amass wealth or create problems for people not to be able to do things that
you can still take that gift that will, you know, kind of create problems for you in your line of work. And that can still amount to corruption.
Yes, that is why we have to be very careful. We have to be very, very careful. Because sometimes it's not corruption because of our culture. And we have to define where our culture and corruption meets. And where the corruption and our culture meets, where they've gone wrong, we should punish them like they're being punished. Maybe they say, oh, the government is not pushing it hard enough. The course has to be fast. Our course are slow, just like anywhere in the world. And that is why the European, the British, is the long arm of the law. Let's believe in the law courts and let them do their job and let those who have committed these crimes be punished. And once there are more punishments, you see people will stop doing it. I know Ghanaians, they don't want to be embarrassed. And once the people are getting embarrassed and people are talking about it, because people know what is going on. A lot of the time they don't want to talk about it.
You sound very passionate about this. Have you ever been accused of being corrupt?
No, nobody has accused me of being corrupt. But I feel it hurts me to see it happen. And nobody's doing anything about it. They just point to the president. And those who are blaming the president, they have been seeing corruption. I'm sure they have been seeing corruption. And in their own time, what did they do about it? At least this gentleman is doing something about it. And let's help him. Let's help the current president to quash corruption. If he's doing something, it's better to do something about it than not to do anything about it.
For that officer who is found to be corrupt in a GCPP government, how would you deal with an officer that is found to be corrupt, say, in a GCPP government? How would you deal with that person?
If all the issues are very clear, one, you sack the person. If it's, you have to be very careful to sack somebody, because if you don't do the right things, they can come and eat you up. You sack them and they'll go to court and put you in a situation. So it's very important to look at all the legal implications before you get rid of the person. It is for the law courts. If the person has done wrong, put them through the right procedure, let them go to the courts, and let the court decide.
Is this the biggest problem that Ghana is facing?
The whole
battle,
world.
The battle again. No, the world is a huge stage.
Yes.
Let's deal with our small corner. Here, is this our biggest problem? Corruption.
It is. It is our biggest problem. It is our biggest problem. It is our biggest problem. But we can do something about it. It's not. Do you think all Ghanaians like corruption? Of course not. Majority don't want it. They want it to be solved. So we should all be, you know, in the UK growing up, you see, if somebody sees something wrong, they'll call the police. We should be more proactive to call and to put people on the spot so that they are found out. And in that way, corruption will go down.
Right, let's look at the current voters register. And I've read reports where you talk about people, specifically political parties, to leave the Electoral Commission alone to do their job.
Absolutely. You see, we have a democracy, it's so wonderful, and we are talking about it. There was a time you couldn't even say anything. But we've gone the other way around. We've gone beyond the freedom that we have. That even when the judges come out with the rule, we are disputing it. We're all confused now. Are we not confused? The Electoral Commission, chairperson, is a lawyer. And she has maybe two or three lawyers with her as well. And then they have their own lawyer. And they've looked through the Supreme Court judgment. And they said, look, they are saying we are not supposed to take care of those with the NIA S cards. We went to that, IPAC meeting. She said that we all sat down. Nobody said anything. Nobody argued with her. The moment we got out, everything was upside down. If they are not happy with what the Electoral Commission is saying, they should go to court. And so that the court will give a clear rule, clear, that everybody will understand it. Because as of now, all the lawyers are fighting among themselves. I know Otu is a good lawyer. He's saying that the Electoral Commission has to delete the NHIS. That's what the court said. In the Bugre is also a good lawyer. I say, no, that's not what they're saying. So who do we trust? Who do we believe? Look, sometimes in the legal language, it's difficult for the ordinary person to understand it because of the way it's written. But now the democracy and then politics is going to all these things. We don't know where we belong now. It's very tough. And if we don't watch it, we're going to have a huge problem on our hands. If we don't respect the EC and anything that they say, we fight against them because we want our party to win at all costs. And because what they are saying is not good for us, and we're going to fight them all the way. Are we going to fight them all the way to the elections? Are we going to have a credible...
So you see, like, dark clouds gathering?
It's awful. It should not go. Look, Rwanda used to be lovely like Ghana. And then what happened? One wrong message on the radio, the whole country went into bits. I'm getting worried, very, very worried about what's going on.
What do you see?
What I see is we have too much of the democracy that we're putting into a different level of confusion. Can't we have a system where once a decision is made, we all accept what the judge has said, and then we go ahead and move the country forward? Can't we do that? Why are we not doing that? And why are the lawyers not helping us to do that? I think it's up to the lawyers to do the writing and put the thing straight so that we can. Because growing up in the UK, if there's a law, comes in, we all understand it and we accept the brother's law and we follow it. But right now it looks as though when the judgment comes out, you have two schools of thought and confuses everybody.
Are we too free or just lawless?
A combination of both. And we have to start thinking that Ghana is better than any political party. If you want to win an election, go and campaign like I'm campaigning now. You can think I'm joking, but I'm campaigning. Go and campaign and win your elections or lose the elections there. And don't let us bring so many problems for the Electoral Commission to handle. Right now to 7th November, there's so many things they have to do. And every time, we are piling on top. Even the
Let my vote count. They say they will physically prevent people who have registered with NHIS cards from voting. What is your reaction
Look
to that?
At that. Is that correct? Gentlemen saying that. You have the complaint form. If somebody is not right, you pick the complaint.
It, yeah.
Yes. And then you go and challenge the form. You don't physically go and hold. Physically means you've lost your train of thought and you're going to fight. Is that what we want in Ghana?
Well, we'll expect the laws to deal with
absolutely. I'm sure the youth don't want it. The youth want a better Ghana. They want Ghana to move forward. They want a richer Ghana agenda. Not fighting because you want to win election. Fight. Go and convince them with your ideas. It may be good, it may not be good. But when they buy it, they'll vote you into power.
What frustrates you about being a politician in Ghana?
Just like I've told you, we've gone to a point where we have so much freedoms to a point that we don't know how to use a freedom. And we are rather bringing it to a point of conflict every time. Every time. Look, it's only recently that I'm talking. For about 6 months, I never said anything. I sat down and just watched things go on. Then I couldn't cope with it anymore. Because when if you say this, this guy is an NDC man. You say this A against NDC, he's an MPP man. Because the system has become so polarized. Ghanaians, please look into my eyes and read my lips. Please vote a new political party into power. Vote those of us who have the policies to change Ghana around into power. And then all this partisan thing will change. Otherwise, we'll end up having a horrible, horrible elections with a war. Every time you say, let's have peace before, during, and after the elections. Why?
You definitely sound frustrated, and you seem very passionate about this country.
I believe in what I'm saying because it worries me.
And you said so many beautiful things in the past. Why do you think Ghanaians are not listening to you?
They are listening. The only thing is they think, if it's a small party, they can't win an election, so they don't vote. And that is where the problem is. We can win it, so give it to us. Don't say they're a small party, so if we are wasting our vote. You are not wasting your vote. Let's do that for the first time and change Ghana, because all of us can do it. We can all change Ghana and make Ghana a richer Ghana agenda.
Is the GCPP open to measure?
Measure in what way?
Teaming up with other smaller political parties.
If you are in politics, you have to be able to mix. You have to be able to listen to people.
The votes obviously are dwindling, and we all see what is happening.
My vote,
for me, that will be magic. Come November 7th, show this.
Let's change that. Don't say it's always. You see, that's why we're having the problem. You always, it's always dwindling. We can't do anything. Let the MPP, NDC win. No!
You want a change from that mentality?
Absolutely.
But are you not worried about alliances? I heard you speaking on one interview where you said you felt tricked. Your father had been tricked by the MPP in an alliance that you had, I think, in 2004, and you warned him against going into that alliance, but he didn't. Does that make you wary?
It wasn't the MPP. It was when they had the Grand Coalition.
The Grand Coalition.
Coalition.
Does that make you advise your father?
At the time, I knew that there was something going on, and that they wanted to use him to get to where they were going to get.
Who are using him?
I will not mention it, but I saw it and I said that this is going to happen. Fight your own fight and move forward, because you have ideas. You've been able to help General Champong. Those who are trying to learn there haven't achieved anything. You were the one who helped Champong to
Operation Feed Yourself.
Absolutely. That's the one in the state and all that. He was there. The moment he left, then there was a problem because Champong had people around him, and unfortunately, he started doing Kalabuli and other things, and then Rollins came to overthrow him because it was wrong.
Could that be something probably that is coming back to haunt the GCPP?
No.
Because it is public that your father single-handedly funded Champong's coup.
Who said?
It's in the reports. I have read.
You read it where?
Well, I'm reading even as I'm talking to you. I just read just before coming here.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
I'm telling you. Do you think that this is something that could have been affecting the GCPP like now?
What could be affecting? Look, GCPP is strong. When all the 275 constituencies, because we know that there's a policy that can change Ghana's fortunes, we are pushing eat what you grow what you eat, add Ghana economic empowerment to move forward. How can that be a problem? It's not.
Probably the history of funding a coup. But listen, if you just joined us, we're having this discussion with presidential candidate GCPP, Dr. Henry Herbert Maumlate. well, he yeah. says that he has all it takes to lead this country. And so you heard him. What are your decisions? Go on to our social media platforms. If you have any other questions for him, send them to our platform 0288-500-600 for WhatsApp, and we'll read them out to him, and he definitely will give you the responses. With the elections as well, you didn't tell us exactly what you think about the current voters register as it stands. Any problem with it?
He's gone to court. We're all trying to, including the EC, we're all trying to clean it up. There's a process. At IPAC, they gave us the plan from 22nd of December and how they're going to clean it up. So we've got to the point of limited registration. Mm-hmm. Now they're going to do the, I've forgotten the other one.
Validation?
No, not the validation. Continuous registration. Okay. And it will go on.
Indeed.
Including every political party, if you find that you know somebody who did not use the right method to register, mm-hmm. simple. Complaint form and go and challenge it.
Okay.
It's as simple as that.
All right. It's 7:40. You're watching GH1 TV live across the world on GH1TV.com. Our guest is Dr. Latte. Yes, GCPP flag bearer.
I'm enjoying every bit of it.
This is GH1 TV on, on GH1 TV, GH Today, mm-hmm. with Kafui and Beswa. And just let us know whether you're going to work because of whether the rain has affected you're going to work or not. We'd like to find out from you later. But for now, we're speaking with Dr. Latte. He's from the GCPP, he's the flag bearer. He wants to be president. He's been giving us a sense of his vision and what he thinks Ghana needs to do to get to where we want the entire country to get to. What would be your foreign policy since we've come out of world in 60 seconds? How would GCPP relate to the rest of the world?
Relate to the rest of the world? Well, I don't think Ghana has a bad foreign policy as of now. So we'll follow the same system. We talk about non-alignment, but now it's not there anymore. We want to be able to keep the world safe and peace against terrorism. We should be able to be part of the World Committee, be able to produce and help with adding value to people's lives.
So you support the arrival of the Gitmo 2 and the Syrian refugees? You support that?
Not support. The point is we are part of the world. And all, most of the world decided that America was doing something wrong by snowboarding and all these people, and that put them in the wrong place. So they should stop it. Obama said, okay, I'm going to do something about it, but I need help. A lot of countries decided to help, and Ghana too has decided to help as part of the world community. Look, our peace mission is one of the best in the world, peacekeeping missions. So maybe they look at Ghana and say, these people have a system where they know how to
keep
peace. Mm. So let's give them these people to also hold them for the period that we need. And you can't say you don't want to help the world if the America's having a problem. You turn your back on them. If you have a problem, would they come and help? Would they come and help you? They wouldn't.
No, no nation lives in a
those are the calculations Absolutely. You have to make.
So it was, we had to do it.
So it was
even if Nanadu was in power, he would have done it. You wouldn't say he wouldn't do it.
You think so?
I'm telling you. It's easy when you're not in the position to say you wouldn't do it. But how long did it take Nanadu to come and say he make a statement on it?
So you think he would have done it?
He would have done it. I would have done it.
You would have done it. What do you think of Trump? It's likely he may win the Republican nomination.
You see, Trump is a good businessman.
Like
him. And I respect him a lot. But some of his political ideas are not quite correct.
Which ones?
Against Muslims. Mm-hmm. One. Two, against immigration. For what reason? No,
he says he wants to secure the borders of his country.
The world does not live in isolation.
He wants to build a wall to prevent the Mexicans
and he doesn't want to pay for
jumping
it.
Over.
Yeah,
he and wants to make the Mexicans pay for it.
Is it possible?
Because their people are jumping
is
over.
Is it really possible? It's not possible.
He says we're getting support from
the
Americans.
He says things that people want to hear. And then the American people want to hear because living outside, I know how these people think. The moment you bring patriotism, you say things that makes them happy, then they will be following you.
Why are we not like that? Why don't you tell us things that we want to hear?
Well, I'm trying to say what we want to hear. And let's hope they realize that Ghanaians want to be able, in their lifetime, be able one day to buy their own homes, be able to buy their own cars, be able to travel around the world, be able to have enough money to pay for their school fees, be able to live a life that is worth living. And look, one thing that worried me a lot when I was there, I was invited by the state of Bremen
in Germany
to set up my office, Latte Associates in Bremen, into the single market. And I'll be well done, always in a suit. I don't wear the suits anymore. Well, always in a suit, going out to do my business and things. And then you go into a bar or a restaurant or a hotel, and then they show Africa, and you see poverty. And they're looking at me, and I'm getting embarrassed, looking at all this premium proper. I want that to change. We should make it so good that in the future, in the next 40 years, which the National Development Planning Commission has come in, and six of the of us, the NDC, NPP, PNC, CPP, and PPP, we went around the country. And do you know what? All the youth and all the stakeholders were saying, we want domestication. We want eat what you grow, grow what you eat. We want to have our own resources, produce and export so that we have... They all told us, all of them. That's why I'm fired up. Everywhere we went, they told us what they want. So if I'm saying that, I'm sure they'll vote us into power, and then we'll put Ghana forward.
So the response on the ground looks good.
Very good indeed.
And coming back to foreign policy, the GCPP's own way of handling, you know, dealings with other countries, right. You seem to subscribe to what we currently have in place.
Absolutely.
You're sounding very much pro-government. This one, you said early on as well, you as well like the way that the current government is tackling corruption, for instance.
Of course.
So I'm asking myself that, why would I vote for you if you already like what is in place?
We're going to do even better. We're going to do even better than they're doing now. So vote for us. We're going to even make it better. You don't dock a government when things are going wrong. Do you knock your home and it's going wrong? No. You stand together and build your home. So we should stand together and build Ghana.
What are they doing
and if
wrong?
We build Ghana... Mm-hmm. If we build Ghana, we'll all be better off.
What is the NDC doing wrong? What is the NDC administration doing wrong where you think you can come in and change things?
What I'm saying, they are not helping the exporting sector enough. And it's not even the NDC government.
Let's reflect. Let's stay
what
with them.
Had happened?
They are in charge
right.
now.
Yeah. Those who are exporting pineapples, I was exporting organic pineapples at one point. They called me and said, Henry, what can you do for us? We are having problems. And what do we have to do is to help the exporters by giving them enough resources to be able to... You just can't get up and export to Europe. You have to have a global GAP certificate. One, if you want to send organic, you have to have organic certificate. And if you're dealing with small agro farmers, you'll need fair trade to be able to get premium prices. We should be able to give them all those facilities or stimulus or funding to be able to qualify for this and then export to end the resources. That is how we can change Ghana. And help the farmers. Give them capacity. But number one, give the money to them in their pocket because they know how to do it. When I financed my farmers, they grew and we became the best in the world. See, most of the time, the banks are scared. If you go to any village, the easiest thing, if you ask who is the best farmer, they'll tell you. If you don't do your research properly, and once you get the best farmer, you do an audit. We had auditors. We had our own auditor who used to go to the farm every time and check what they are doing. If they are doing something wrong, we get to know it. And then we call the right services, agricultural services people, to come and help solve it out. So if you do that and you help the farmer to produce properly and help him with capacity building, food production will go up. We have food sufficiency. We'll be able to have enough resources. And then we'll be able to build a better Ghana. And the better or richer Ghana agenda that we have is to be able to build more schools. Infrastructure is very important. Build more schools, build more hospitals, so that if people are ill, they'll be properly taken care of because your health is just as good as... If you don't have good health, the economy will not move. We need to have, just like the UK and other places have, you can go to hospital and don't have to pay for it. But we have to work and earn that money to be able to come out with those policies. So it's export
all the way.
Absolutely.
Let me come to you personally. How has your life changed since you became flag bearer of the GCPP?
It's changed in a way that I don't go out as much as I used to do, because I used to go out a lot.
Where did you?
I used to go to +233.
You're a jazz man or a reggae man?
I'm both jazz and reggae. I used to go to the Bam Tavern. Qantas was a good friend of mine. I was always there, and I met all the... Funny enough, you meet all the top people, the movers and shakers of the economy. You meet them there. But now I'm getting calls from my constituents. I cannot be in a place when people are calling me, my party members.
And you're chilling.
And I'm chilling. I can't do that. You know, you can't even do that. Every 2 minutes you'll be out talking to somebody, and it's not worthwhile. Occasionally, I go. During our Congress, I brought Muta Baruka and
Tony Rebel
in. And then we had a big time at the 233. It was fantastic. All the reggae guys came in, all business people. It was fantastic. It was a lovely, lovely evening. But we can mix business with pleasure. We can mix business with pleasure. It's not all pleasure and all business. But let's do the things that will put Ghana in a place that we'll all be proud of. We should not give up.
What's in this for you? You're a successful businessman. You single-handedly have sponsored your party over the years. Why do you want to do this?
Because
after... You almost sound like Ayarika.
Well, after a point, I'm Dr. Henry Latte. After a point...
He's also Dr. Ayarika, by the way. He's also a businessman.
After a point, you see that all that is better, you use that energy that is left. I'm now in my 60s.
I think you're just kind of throwing money away. Well, if you ask me.
No, look. You can throw money away just going to have a drink and just have and get drunk or a bit merry and then go and sleep. Is that not throwing money away? Why don't you do more to help everybody else? At least one day, if I don't win, somebody who believes in domestication will do something to change Ghana.
You are self-actualizing. This is the pinnacle of your achievements. You've done everything. All your needs are sorted out, and now you're just actualizing yourself.
It gets to a point in your life. Mm-hmm. Where you ask yourself, I'm doing this, should I continue like this? This way of having fun, I've traveled around the world.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot.
Yes.
And what I've seen, I know
we can also get there.
We can prove that Ghana, we can create a situation where we can live that sort of lifestyle.
Yes. I know you're an accountant.
Yes.
Going through the books, how much have you spent so far on this campaign?
Is it necessary to let everybody know?
It is.
If it's necessary.
That was what I was actually coming to before we jumped in. Yeah.
Well, we've spent
a heck of a lot of money.
But
it's a lot.
One followed by how many zeros?
Well, it's gone. The Electoral Commission will know that. So, I don't think MPP will come and tell you how much they spent.
He had spent about a million.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. As of the time that he came into, he had spent about a million.
Would it not be public knowledge if you go and tell the Electoral Commission?
Well, it's about the same, actually.
It's about $1 million.
Yes, not dollars.
CDs.
Like CDs.
Yes, about
the. Is that expensive? Yeah. Where does a chunk of the money go through to in running, prosecuting,
running?
A presidential campaign?
You have to have your constituency elections. Mm-hmm. In order 275, and then after that you have to have your regional elections, in each region, before you have your national congress, and your national congress you have about how many? 50 trucks coming out throughout the whole country, to Kumasi. That's what we did. So, 50 VIP trucks came throughout the whole country.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had over 3,000 young men and women, vibrant, who want to make Ghana a better place. And you should have seen it. Muta Baruka and Tony Rebel could not believe it. He said, Dr. Latte, in Jamaica we don't go to any political function, but we have come to you because I met them in Jamaica in 2014. And I said, I'm going to have my congress and I want you to come. They said, we will come. I even didn't believe them until the last minute, and then they came. They said they've never seen so many youth in a place who are so enthusiastic. And if they will do what they are showing on the floor, then we have a chance of winning.
And all of those monies are coming from your businesses?
Coming from friends, coming from donations, coming from cash in kind. That's where it's come from.
How are we able to keep track? And you're an accountant, like Kafu said earlier on. How are you able to keep track of all of these monies that are coming in? How are we able to tell how much money is coming in, what is going out?
That is why we have a statement of account. And then we have a treasurer who does all this, and he does that. I don't get it.
What would be your response? You cannot lead this country, Dr. Latte, because you don't understand Ghanaians.
Me? You think I don't understand Ghanaians? No, I do, because I listen. That's the way you understand Ghanaians. I listen a lot. We've gone around and we're listening. I went around with the NDPC and I listened.
What are they telling you?
They're telling me that they want domestication. They want eat what you grow, grow what you eat. We should be able to produce, not only in agriculture, in any business, in the energy sector. We should be able to produce it ourselves and export. We have to compete. We shouldn't say, because other people are doing it, we can't do it. Even the students. Even the young students, the SHS students, were saying that everywhere we went, they were mentioning that we should move forward and also improve our education. Not only with just put chupo and forget, but we should add vocational and technical, very, very important. Also, we shouldn't wait till they get to university before we start teaching them certain subjects, because at that age, they are fresh, their minds are fresh, and they can grasp a lot, like a sponge. They'll be able to grasp a lot so that we can move this country forward. In the next 40 years, we want to be in a state where we just don't have everything just sprawling. We should plan. We have our railways all the way to northern region. We should be able to have, if even underground, we should be able to have underground. We should plan this forward and build, not just go to court and fight the courts when we should be planning to build this country and move this country forward. That's what we should be doing.
Listen, we've spoken to people in the arts industry who have felt over the years that the industry has been neglected.
Yes.
What is the plan for
it's
the arts?
So important. Look, America is huge because of movies, because of music. If we do not put money there enough to enhance the creative arts, we won't get anywhere as much as we want to. When we say the American Dream, where did they get it from? Because you're watching a movie. It's through movies that we know of the American Dream. And then they show us, look, America is not the dream as we also expect, because when you go, then you go and see the reality. But they are selling the ideas to you on camera. So if we can sell the ideas to people, Ghana is not corrupt. We can do things. We have resources, and we have to actually negotiate properly when they come in and not allow them to take the whole thing away and make them feel comfortable that when they come there, they're going to make money and not be cheated, and they can do good business. By having films that portray these images, you watch the investments that will come in.
If you have the opportunity to sell Ghana, put Ghana, you know, on that pedestal to attract that kind of investment that we talk about, how would you go about it?
I have exhibited in all most of the world trade shows, and that is how I exhibited my business. I'm sure I'll do. You need to network. You need to visit, just like Kufuor did. Visit most of the president, and Mahama is also doing. Visit most of the big countries. Network with the president. Network with business. And listen to them, and also find a way to convince them that this is a point of call, the gateway to Africa, like we've all been saying. And you watch what will happen. If you don't work, nothing happens.
Dr. Latte, so I put the question out. I asked people on Twitter why they see the phenomenon of smaller parties with their leaders always running to the elections every 4 years. Most people know they can't win. Why do they do it? And then the response was that, well, they are doing it for their own personal profit. It raises their social standing. They get lots of freebies, state protocol. And when they die, they give them a state burial.
Oh, no. Look, if I die, I should be cremated. I'm not interested in a state burial.
You want to be cremated?
Yeah.
Why?
Because, look, if you go to a Sioux cemetery where I was born, it's full up. Why are they going to dig somebody else and put you on top of it?
But when you die, you will not know what is going on.
Well, I've told them what they should do. In the process, it's not because of, look, doing business outside, I had a lot of respect in Germany, in the UK. I walk into the UK, you think I live there. But inside me, something was hurting that my country should just be good as this and not be, Henry Latte, talking black guy, doing well. Mm. No, we should do much, much better than that.
Kafui's last question got you laughing. I hardly see you laugh. Apart from this question.
I laugh a lot.
You do? Okay, yeah. I should be engaging you more.
Maybe your lips are hidden under the beard.
No, it's because we're talking about something that is very important. When you're talking about serious issues,
you don't laugh.
There's no man.
Indeed.
When you laugh, it looks as though you're not serious about what you're talking
about. I should accompany you one of these days to +233, for instance.
Oh, they'll tell you.
Just to see you laugh. I mean, apart from this last question that Kafui posed to you that got you laughing, what makes you laugh?
What makes me laugh?
Gets you excited.
It's very simple. It's very simple things in life. Somebody who can crack jokes. And things like that.
You got a favorite comedian, Ghanaian comedian?
Well, I'm one of the old Osofo Dazi.
Oh, you love that.
And this new guy who's called Kalibos.
You love Kalibos?
I like him a lot.
You like him.
You know, when you watch some of his adverts, he's hilarious. And the guy who does the banana.
Jokoto.
Yes.
Kwame Jokoto.
I like
you
him.
Like that?
Absolutely.
All right. How about music?
Music, Ghana music. I'll go for Ambule.
Okay.
I'll go for Shatawale.
Oh, really? Wow. Which Shatta song?
Shatta.
All his songs.
Can you sing any of them?
Kakai.
Yeah, sing it for me.
I can't sing it, but I love it. I'm not good.
Hi.
You see? And then, Sarkodie.
You like Sarkodie?
I like Sarkodie.
Did you try any of his
rounds? Kwabna.
So you're kind of like all the
You like Kat Thomas? Yes. Oh, okay. Mm. Movie actresses. Favorite?
The Why favorite? Actresses?
Favorite actress.
I don't want to say I have favorite. I like a lot of them.
Which ones? Top three.
Yvonne Nelson, I like very much. Mm-hmm. Juliet Ibrahim, mm-hmm. lovely. Mm-hmm. Okoro.
Yes, Yvonne Okoro.
Yvonne Okoro.
Okay.
Wow. And the rest.
The guys? Excellent. Any names?
Dumelo.
Okay.
There's Van Vicker, there is
yes.
Majid,
those are three.
Those are your people.
Oh, okay. Right. I just give them to you. Right?
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Well, it's great. It's nice to see the other side of you too. So good question there to
so
bring out.
So did I show myself too serious?
Well,
no, you were talking serious issues.
You're talking serious stuff.
Now wait.
I had a grandfather like that who rarely laughed. He said life was a serious business, so you
Indeed.
Don't go around laughing too much. So
Indeed.
So I agree with that. So thank you so
I've
much.
I've enjoyed myself coming here because it's important. That's this is me. Mm-hmm. I don't hide anything. I say it like it is. Mm. If you like it, you come with me. If you don't like it, try and listen again and come with me.
Dr. Latte, thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure.
Pleasure, Doc. Well, you heard him. He says, if you like it, well, if you don't, try and listen.